background, 1980, the Killer Angels. Ron Maxwell was able to get some funding, but the deal was it had to be filmed in Europe, basically Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia, and used the soldiers there. Why? Because they had balloon uniforms and they had gray uniforms. But the deal was, we will put the money in this picture, but you have to use the actor Charlton Heston as Robert E. Lee. And you have to use, to play General Longstreet, Marlon Brando. Thank God it never happened. And then finally, when we finally got the funding to make the movie, if we were going to make this movie in 1990, Robert Duvall would have been Robert E. Lee. It was all set. And then the next year, 91, Robert Duvall was all set. Then, you know, just things happen, you lose your funding, etc. And finally, he just finished doing Stalin for HBO, and he finished doing Lonesome Dove for CBS, and he didn't want to do another miniseries because this was supposed to be a miniseries. So here was the lineup for Robert E. Lee. Now we're filming in 1992. It's springtime. We have to get a Robert E. Lee. First choice for Robert E. Lee for the movie Gettysburg, Paul Newman. Went after Paul Newman twice. But no, he turned it down because he doesn't do television. See, we're going for a TV movie, miniseries. Then they went after James Gardner. Then they went after John Voight. Tom Berenger wanted his good friend, the great Irish actor, Richard Harris, to play Robert E. Lee. But Richard Harris said no. He did not want to take on that great American icon. And then it got to a point where it's a month before filming and we still don't have a Robert E. Lee. So we go after George C. Scott. And Scott comes back and says, I've already played my general. General Patton. Well, finally, then, matter of, I think, 3 weeks, and then we finally go after Martin Sheen, and he turns us down. Why? Because he knew what it would be like in Gettysburg in the summer with the wool on and with the hair and the beard and everything. So finally his wife was the one who convinced him to take on the role of Robert E. Lee. So Martin Sheen ended up playing Lee. And then finally, 9 years later on down the road, we asked Martin Sheen again to play the part, but then he's involved with West Wing. He's committed to West Wing, he could not get out to do the film. And so, the person that was supposed to play Robert E. Lee back in 1991, we got, and that was Robert Duvall. He basically got a crash course in Robert E. Lee. I think he did a magnificent job. I really do. And same thing for Robert Duvall, what he had to do, because he's such a definitive actor that sometimes before he would do a scene, I would go into his trailer, and he would pick my brain on different parts of the character, just so he could add it on to the performance. So I gotta say, I'm really torn. I love Martin Sheen for his performance and also what Robert Duvall did. To be honest with you, I think Robert Duvall wasn't used as much as he should have been for Guys and Generals. I truly believe that. So, Gettysburg. But then later on, his good friend Billy Campbell ends up playing Pickett in Guys and Generals. And the reason, well, you see, other actors were being thought of for the role of Jackson. I mean, I'll tell you right now, some of the names that were thought about for Jackson. You had Russell Crowe for Jackson. Yeah. You had Ed Harris for Jackson. Long time, about a year or so ago, they thought about Tom Hanks as Jackson. Now here's one for you, ladies and gentlemen. There was contract talks. There was talks on the 4th of July. Remember we started filming at the end of August? Well, 4th of July, we still didn't have a Jackson. So 4th of July, 2001, there was talks with George Clooney to play Jackson. So Stephen Lang ended up taking the role, and he is the definitive Jackson. All of the Jacksons be compared to Stephen Lang as Jackson. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. wonderful job up here. He's a good guy. I like him a lot. I've seen him a lot. Dan Evans' first song that he ever wrote, that he was 14 years old when he wrote it, and I guess it's something to do with his dog, which is named Tucker, but we're not sure.
Old damn Tucker.
Myself, I place a battery called the 2nd Main Battery right up by that barn. It's along the Cashtown Road. And I'm watching the action and seeing things happen, but obviously the Confederates are getting on the field quicker than my units are. Three units I sit on the north side of the road, two on the south side of the road. You that I could tell you more about the Battle of Gettysburg, but I can't. But I can answer some questions up until July 1st, 1863, if you'd like me to. I've either overwhelmed you or you're all in stunned silence.
What happened to you?
Does anyone might want to tell this gentleman what happened to me?
This is General Meade.
I had no reservations. What I'm saying is it's a very highly politicized command in the Army of the Potomac. You must have friends in high places. And Slocum and Sedgwick apparently had some folks in Washington working against them. When I say they are above me, what I mean is my Major General commission dates to November 29, 1862. Sedgwick and Slocum's Major General think that Sickles had possessed the talent to command an Army Corps. I think with him under my command and immediate control that he would do well enough.
Remind you, all of the firing that we are doing today is with inert ammunition. These shells weigh the same as the original ammunition, but they are filled with sand instead of with black powder to make that very special exception for you. The mortar is the only gun in the civil strings, even though it is concealed from the enemy, and then fire those shells in the high arc to get into a fortification, into earthworks, into trenches, into a powder magazine. And as long as there's a forward observer to tell where the shells are falling, they can even fire at night. I read a very interesting account recently of a Union soldier lying in his camp outside of Richmond, and he described in great detail his entertainment as the large 13-inch Seacoast mortar. Long after the ball has exploded, he hears the report, and he claimed that even from several thousand yards away, he could hear the shrieking of the fragments as they flew through the air from that explosion. Received special permission to shoot explosive ammunition. Doing that on our last shot, actually, we received intelligence that the enemy is concealing a large store of powder and munitions under that rather innocuous looking stack of forage.
Much too nice for a private such as Andrew, so we'll save that one for an officer. We'll find some barn siding or planking to nail together a rough box for Andrew. We have his hometown and next of kin that we'll put on the top of the coffin and take it to the railroad station or to but of those that were embalmed, somewhere between 10,000 and 35,000. Many of the embalming surgeons kept pretty good records. Many of them didn't keep records at all. So we're kind of an educated guess at this point. We don't have any definite figures on that. Saw him, were so very pleased and amazed that it catapulted embalming immediately at that point. Not that my reputation goes with that. Most of the bodies I would simply inject as much fluid as I could, and that might take maybe a half hour or so.
Now some of them were like killed, and then they had shallow.
Had an eagle stamped on one side, the back side was blank, and they could either have their name stamped in it or scratch their name, hometown, or regiment in it. This was a precursor to the time he reached Springfield. There were 13 stops on his train trip back to Springfield. At each stop, he was touched up, if you will, embalmed just enough if he needed it. So he was probably the most embalmed body to date. But there was an embalming surgeon that traveled with him on the train and made sure that he was in very acceptable condition before he was viewed. Because at each stop, there would be a funeral procession, there would be a viewing, oftentimes in the Capitol building, the rotunda, or the State House, or some very public place. so it was very important that, that the thousands, literally thousands and thousands of people who saw him, see him as they would remember him.
Do you do this in real life? Well, what made you
I do.
Give it
yeah.
to you? Oh, you do this?
I do.
Oh, okay, okay.
It's been 8 years now. Yeah. We were right by 141 in Manchester.
Chadwick.
Four brothers and a sister were good friends with the Creeks.
Oh, yes. Yes.
So, you were doing a good job. But that
sure,
room too
popular.
See if their tag for the embalmer was there. And number two, write a letter home to mom, write a letter home to their wife, and have one of their buddies mail it home for them. That was about the first thing, because he knew if he pulls up his blouse and he's got blood all over his abdomen, he knew he was going to die. And so, yeah, one of the first things they'll do is rip their shirt off to see if they've got a gun or a chest. That's absolutely right. And then they would write the letter. And a medic, not usually that fast, usually it's blood loss. Because if you, the blood vessels are so packed, and if you accept that that 58 caliber bullet's going into 10 fragments going into your abdomen, there's every possibility one of those fragments is going to hit the inferior vena cava, the aorta, and you're going to bleed out almost immediately. Or at the very least, one of the mesenteric, one of the bowel arteries. And again, you'll bleed out very quickly. Just no matter 10, 15 minutes. E.G. Archer. A-R-C-H-E-R.
This is terrible.
They're going around the place.
He's metal detecting and picking stuff up down in his base truck in South Carolina. And started to come up with some broken glass in the base. And then he stopped and he tried.
That's right. They've been out of the
game. And he was able to get seven of these. And I think three of them have acid and four of them were empty. And the wire.
Where did you find the wire?
Well, this isn't original.
No.
This is actually spark plug wire. And then what they would do is they'd wrap two layers of line around and tar
okay.
to further make
yeah,
it waterproof.
Okay.
But it was so actually a gutta percha, a rubber coating, and get to the fragile gutta percha and wear it through that. So that's the piece. That's the kind of wire they brought that in from Nassau into Charleston, and they had a 3,000. Don't worry about that. And he sent me a copy of the whole manuscript, so
wow.
I'm going to have the whole manuscript in.
Wow.
All I have to do is just give the library credit, that's all.
Wow, that's good. But we'll come back and see you again.
Okay.
Take care. God bless.
Gentlemen!
Yes?
Strip down to your major's uniform.
Building lad.
We're almost
messed up. 2,000 feet of film.
General, we're here with orders from General Daniels.
Okay, as soon as we're done here.
Our compliments.
Okay.
10 seconds.
Sir.
10 seconds.
As long as you need, sir.
Just wait here.
We shall wait. And it wasn't like it happened once.
Oh, yeah, I know.
It happened time and time again in the East and in the West that these guys would put themselves into the mouth of death time and time again, knowing.
Underfed, overworked.
Underpaid.
Yeah, no pay sometimes.
Yeah, right. Sometimes it was 2, 3, 4 months before they got paid.
Yeah. Right. And nowhere to be. 100 degree weather.
There was one of the areas. No gunfire in. That's where the battle was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Like there were people who died after the battle from the smoke of the burning of the pocket.
Yeah. Pocket said
it was so much smoke that they inhaled it and from died from the smoke.
And the smoke of the fort was new.
Yeah.
The man they're marching off with, that is the girl I left behind me.
Savings time. So Soldier's Day would begin at the beginning of morning nautical twilight, which is this latitude in early July. So we come up to the Bedeck Line, this port of the part of the Bedeck Line, around the Chambersburg Pike, is commanded by Lieutenant Marcellus Jones, 8th Illinois Cavalry. He sees the Confederates coming through the morning coast. Reaches over to the platoon sergeant. Confederate skirmishers coming in the far. Imagine this now to be Hair Ridge. That's Pegram's Confederate Artillery Battalion on Hair Ridge. Horse artillery, Buford's division responds. Federal artillery. Thank you.
Some horrific tales of animals with their entrails shot out racing down the Chambersburg Pike, only to be put out of their misery by a kind. As you can see, the lines are giving way under pressure of the advancing Confederates, because when the Confederates arrive on the field, of course, they will be numerically. Percent of their strength of the horses don't have the firepower, even though they have breech-loading weapons, to oppose a rifled musket. Troops troops, all that smoke, I've never seen a reenactment extend over such terrain like the real battle. Doing a great job dismounted, holding up the Confederates until the Union infantry of the 1st Corps arrives. Now it's remounted, and we'll go back to the traditional cavalry role of Devon's Cavalry Brigade on the north, posting Yerko and Gamble's Brigade going south and taking positions along Seminary Ridge. extending from Oak Ridge down Seminary Ridge all the way to the Hagerstown Road.
Over Seminary Ridge.
look up to the south and see on the high ground about where the Lee Monument is today. Gamble's Union Cavalry Brigade mounted. The last thing any future commander wants on his flank, open flank, is mounted cavalry. So James Lane goes into the classic infantry defense against cavalry attack. But of even greater import to that, because Lane, who's one third of that division, a big brigade, is withdrawn, his combat power is withdrawn from the battle. Even more important, had he not gone, but first of all, in the square, the good thing he did, he had the good thing to do, had he been able to continue to slip.
Yeah. Philadelphia International Airport, right?
Yep.
And we just went behind a bank.
Yeah.
11 o'clock.
It's 11 o'clock. it's somewhere. No, I know he...
Happy birthday, Todd.
Underwear is hanging out the bottom.
And my happy papping.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, buddy. Pap, I'll all see right. you later.
Okay.
You check,
stop by once in a while.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks for the birthday present.
All righty. Thank you.
Uh-huh. I'm glad you came out.
Yes, thank you for that. Yeah. Especially the
Oh, yeah.
Hey, Todd, that looks great.
Hard work and determination paid off.
That's right. It's a beautiful sign.
Jesus, Frank, I don't get myself in the vision.
Don't you really? We need to be in there a little bit. How's it looking now?
Made this one higher.
Just a little bit.
We need to take a little out now.
Yeah. About an inch.
Okay. Todd's doing a pretty good job, huh?
That's
fair, yeah. It's a nice sign. It's about 20 after 6 here in the evening on Thursday, September the 18th, and they're calling for high winds and heavy rains tonight caused by Hurricane Isabel. So we're just kind of surveying the property to see what it looks like before, and hopefully it'll look the same afterwards. Put the screens out of the attic windows and put the windows back in. The roof's in pretty good pack. New chimney. The TV antenna. On the porch, we took all the furniture in except for the swing, and it's now down on the floor. We took all the little ornamental things that were hanging there, put them away. We have Emily's car, 2000 Nissan Maxima. Underneath the carport and behind it is my 92 Chevy Lumina Euro. It's not quite under the carport, it won't fit, but it's just in the driveway behind it. Todd's going to park out here on the street tonight. There's only place he can park. Emily's Maxima. Chevy Lumina. Good shape for a 92 car. Like I said, we have taken the furniture off except for the swing, which is now resting on the floor. The other way, all we have is a milk can sitting there that should be okay, tucked in the corner. Everything's in good shape here. And we can see Emily's car under the carport. And down here is our garage. There's our birch tree. Inside the garage is two large pin oaks. The wind's starting to pick up now here, close to 6:30. This is a Norway maple. They seem well anchored tonight. We took our picnic tables and turned them upside down and put weights on them. Those sawhorses are actually made out of steel and very heavy, so they're weighting it down. Our grill's down there out of the wind. It's less wind on that, typically, on that side of the garage. The awning over the back stoop there, we have it anchored down with twine. So hopefully if a gust of wind comes along, it won't rip it off. On our side yard here, we have this nice ash tree, mountain ash, but it's a different kind of a mountain ash. I forget if it's European or Japanese, but it's a nice, valuable tree. Hopefully it doesn't get damaged. And behind that, we have nine bark and a viburnum and a hedge of barberry. Gorgeous barberry. That variety is slips my mind, but it's a good purple variety. Morley speckled, one of the better ones there are. This is a large burning bush. A hedge of arborvitaes. A beautiful Serbian spruce coming on there. A knockout rose with an azalea behind it. And there's some ornamental grass, a gorgeous Miss Kim lilac, and a nice boxwood behind there. And this is a red spire ornamental pear. And this large tree here is our Coosa dogwood. It's, you can see it's full of red fruit. And in front of it is an azalea there. This flower bed. This is a one of the new nine barks with the purple leaves. The name slips me right now, but it's one of the better varieties that they've come out just recently with. Several perennials in there. Ornamental grass. This carport's been anchored to that house. Always seems to be well structured. It's held a lot of snow loads in the past 19 years that we've lived here, and never shows any signs of stress. So we just trust that it'll stay firm this time, this storm. We've got chimney and antenna. The back door, as I said earlier, we have this extra spring going over the awning so that, through the bracing so that it'll strengthen that for high winds. This big rhododendron there beside the driveway. Basketball hoop there. And this patio that makes a real nice basketball court. And over here we have some shrubbery and a rhubarb, and there's a gorgeous black gum tree. Yeah. One of the nicest watermelons you can have. Here we have some shrubbery in waiting, some daylilies and ornamental grass and foxwoods. And down in here some euonymus waiting. And there's a regal privet. One-of-a-kind azalea there. And behind it's a large bayberry. That's the male, and the female is on around the corner and gets all the berries. The back porch. It has an awning on the back. No way to really anchor it down anymore. A little awning over top of the back door there. Looking at it from the east side. Those bayberries or Polaris back in there. And here's a gorgeous Serbian spruce. Just a real gorgeous specimen. It's taken several years to get that baby that size. One of the nicest Serbian spruces I've seen anywhere. And Serbian's a superior spruce. And here's that black gum. And over here, this is a Acer Pennsylvanian striped maple. And that's one of the biggest ones I've ever seen in a cultivated setting. It's done real well there. You can see the stripes in the bark. Striped maple or moosewood, I also call it. And then down here along this side of the yard is my, underneath that cover is my classic 1966 Ford Galaxy. Awaiting some restorations. See these clothesline poles. I got my Galaxy covered up all the time and put extra twine around it for the high winds so that it wouldn't get ripped off. On the normal winds, it stays pretty steady, but who knows what about this one's coming this summer tonight. So we wrap extra twine around it. And down back here, we have a lilac over here in the corner, you know, on that spruce branch. And at the back of the alley, we have a gorgeous hen-eating hemlock hedge. The hedge goes towards the east there. There's a lilac over there. And from the back of the garage driveway to the west is the other side of the Canadian hemlock hedge. Here's the garage. There's the base of one of those large pin oaks beside the garage here. Inside the garage we have our rabbit cage. I don't have any rabbits at this point in time, but we hope to have some again someday. And everything that I had just kind of sitting around loose, I've got all congregated together and weights on them. There's a new burn barrel that I'm going to put into commission soon, and I got a cement block on it. And I got weights on everything else that would be possibly caught in the wind, prevent the loss of everything like that. Hopefully that'll suffice. And a lot of stuff ended up in the garage for protection. We even put our garbage can in there so we wouldn't lose the lid on it. This is our 2001 Nissan Maxima. It belongs to Sue and I. And it's a great car. Very good shape. And there's our generator and waiting in case we lose power. Spare gas to keep it going as long as we can. This should be out of our hair by 10 to 12 o'clock tomorrow, but I'm just trying to be prepared. We have the kids' bikes in here. Todd's got a nice mountain bike over there, Mongoose. And Emily's got a bike in there, just a conventional road bike. I was refinishing a door from the kitchen and I brought it out here to stay out of the storm. Under this cover here, I have some antique classic, not classics, but pictures from my past ancestry, a heritage. A lot of valuable stuff under there that I sure wouldn't want to lose. There's our new cargo carrier that we got to carry our bikes to rails, to trails, and other points when we want to ride. One more. We got our little rototiller in there, our Rotoho rototiller. It's been a faithful piece of equipment. Underneath the table there is our snowblower, Toro snowblower. A couple of shop vacs that still work good. There's our bicycles, Sue's bikes and I, they're giants. Mine's brand new this year and Sue's is only 1 year old. And they cost us around $300 a piece. There's our bike carrier again. In the cargo rack. I just put a brand new garage door opener in this spring. Now we had some problems with it. I got it ripped open there trying to figure out the problem. I haven't solved it yet, but just installed it this spring. And a lot of other various items in here, ladders, wagons, spare lumber, tools. My gardening tools over here in the corner. Fertilizer spreader. And a biggest ladder. There's my family heritage pictures and records there again. This generator is still in great shape. I ran it a little over a half hour today to make sure we were in good shape for use it if in case. It seems to be running beautiful. Pretty big. It's the Norway maple wonder. There's our picnic tables. These steel, actually iron sawhorses on there for weight. I would think that they ever go through them instead of having any lifting surfaces there. Grill, rabbit trap. There's my wife in there, Susan Elizabeth Dinsmore. She's my sweetie. Thank you, Lord, for giving me her. So we're just trusting that the Lord will spare us and everybody else from any real damage. Neighbor's T-ball's over there. That's a nice house. Door locked tonight. This grate here is a attic vent grate off my great-great-great-grandparents' house down in Greene County, Pennsylvania. Okay, that's it. Hopefully it'll look the same way tomorrow. Thank you, Lord, in advance. That way we'll get a couple more angles here. Our port. Rhododendron. Chivayuro. Alberta spruce, one of the biggest Alberta spruces you'll see around this area. Light post. There's some dogwood. There's that Alberta spruce. Oh, this is a sourwood, really a nice sourwood tree. We're right here at the corner of our porch. And behind it's a umbrella pine. I'll have to show you that in a minute. Here's this gorgeous Serbian spruce. Look how good that looks from the front of the property. See the umbrella pine over there. I would say that's the only umbrella pine that I know in Martinsburg in the southern Blair County. I never see any others. That red spire ornamental pear. The knockout rose. Got a pole there at the corner of our property. And then the next pole, the wires run down our side of the street. And then the next pole's on the east side of Shorty Steel's property. And it has a transformer up there. And on this pole on the west side of our property, our power line comes off there. It comes over here and attaches to our house right there. And then goes down. Our power box right there, underneath that carport. Our phone and our cable TV come in from the alley. We have a combination of annuals and perennials in front. Here's a stilby here, which is a perennial. The annuals are impatiens, Hostas are perennials. There's daylilies that are lilies of valley behind there that we've already cut down for the winter. Some ribbon grass. Of course, Sue has a nice two roses here, a kind of a dark pink one and then a yellow one behind it. And I have daylily crop, which are perennials, some more ornamental ribbon grass. And here's a really nice arborvitae growing here. It's one of the nicer varieties. I forget the name you call it. I can look it up. And it's one of the better ones. And on this side is some more daylilies, stelladoras. Behind there are dianthus. And I forgot to say anything about my great Japanese maple here. You don't see many trees like this. It's a dwarf, low-growing Japanese maple. A lot of people think it's a shrub, but it's actually a tree. You see it with the leaves off. It's got a main stem and then branching. It comes out on a horizontal basis, very low to the ground. Comes out purple and then reverts back to green. There's a little late season growth there. It shows you the purple. Or the spring color. There's the green in the summer. Planted white clover in our area between the sidewalk and the curb last fall, and it got established this summer, and it's just great. It needs trimmed back a little bit right now. I haven't had time, but boy, it came in great. This area used to be full of weeds, and you couldn't grow grass in it, and it really looked bad, and this white clover has been great. This is Shorty and Joanne Steele's car sitting here. Seeing the sprinkles in that big puddle down there. It's just lightly raining at this point in time. Okay, so we're gonna weather out tonight. We'll close with a thing of beauty. A rose. Here we are in Charlottesville, Virginia, on Park Street, at the First Baptist Church, where they're having a first place conference. And it's a beautiful location. As Hurricane Isabel went through here 2 days ago, there's a lot of debris all over the place. Some trees blown down here, there, and everywhere. But this this place seemed to survive pretty good. Beautiful church complex. This is in the floor of the bell tower here. Probably the marker off the original church, built in 1831. And this is the marker off the new, probably the present building we're now, erected in 1877. And on this lower side is an educational wing, like a, you must have a school complex. Set up as classrooms, there's a playground on the back side. Nice campus. Down this driveway to the street, to Park Street, there's some evidence of the Hurricane Isabel. A white pine fell over there. large front yard. These front entrance doors are quite ornate. Solid wood, pretty thick. I'm not sure what these trees are. We don't have them up in the north. They sure are nice. And the trees are surrounded with these holly hedges, which is a unique holly that we don't see up in the north either. Real pronounced loads with sharp points. You don't want to walk into them too far. There's a little prayer garden dedicated in memory of a missionary from the early days of this church, Lottie Moon. Lottie was a missionary in China. For 39 years, and she died on her way home in 1912. Sounds like a pretty great lady. Stonewall Jackson. Statue of General Robert E. Lee here in Lee Park in Charlottesville, Virginia. This is the courthouse. And this was all the historical buildings. This was an auction house at one time. This house actually has the address of 0. Was painted on those bricks. If there was light was just right, you could still read it. This little banister on number nothing. Pretty ingenious. enough to hold on to, and yet not in the way. This was a number of nothing residents. The courthouse across the street. Number 300. Back of the courthouse. We were in there on our tour. We're down there somewhere. This was the old original jail. They took the prisoners in a wagon. They opened this door right here, pulled the wagon in, shut the door, and then load the prisoners and take them on in behind that wall. And on in the prison. I can only assume this was the jailer's house, and we were told that it was jailer's wife's responsibility to feed the prisoners. I assume that's where he lived and maintained the prison. We were told there was quite a few hangings in there over the years. On the back side of the wall of the prison. There was some wall there. If you could smell that or not. Oh, weeds growing out on top of it now. This is City Hall down East Main Street. And across the street we have an amphitheater where I guess they have some pretty good shows all summer long. City Hall. You look up East Main Street, which is now downtown mall. I guess at one time in the old Charlottesville this was the main downtown, and then they'll change it into a the mall setting. It's pretty neat. We learned about Three Knots Road this morning. This is a little theater here in downtown, the old downtown that they're totally refurbishing. It'll be open in the fall of 2004, and big plans for it inside. Straight across there, Charlottesville, right, Seth?
Right.
You'd see the university from here if those leaves were off the trees. And those trees wouldn't be here back when Jefferson lived here. A little damage here from Hurricane Isabel. Hurricane Isabel spares nothing. Although in reality it wasn't that much damage. That's the North Pavilion. And over there is the South Pavilion. So this is the West Lawn. Is the West Lawn in front of the?
Yeah.
So that would be considered a front?
Yes. So there's the...
Can you film me?
Over here. In front of his home, to the left and the right, are two tulip poplars that were there. I assume he planted them, but they were there in his time. One on the north and one over here on the south. And then over here on the north side of the path around the front yard is a red cedar back in there. That was here in his time. Is there debris there from the Hurricane
that Sue? Looks like there's something hanging out of there, like something could be a vine in there.
This is the red cedar that was here in Thomas Jefferson's day. It's all entangled with vines now, really. Not so impressive as a tree, but it's large. This is at Tula Popper on the south side, next to the house that was here. That's the north side. This lawn. The south pavilion. The shutters on the houses are not one long one, they're divided, upper and lower. There's a lower shutter and you can see the division. The upper shutter, two sets of hinges. All around the house. Here's a fig plant grown on the south side of the house. Jefferson had something to do with figs, I believe. I think there's figs in there. We'll take a look. There's some figs coming on. Notice the smaller windows above the long, tall ones. That's the windows on the second floor. They just almost join. You almost wouldn't even think of them as second floor windows. It's part of his design. And on the third floor, there's even a bedroom with roll. They say the ceilings up there are real low and the lights are skylights. See the hay rack above there, put it into this, this is the work area that when it installed the feed and then the horses poured out of that hay rack above them. And here's their feed boxes. Looks to me like they'd bring the horses out here and bring them over this watering trough and water them here. I wonder if there was a spring to come out of there. That's a question we need answered, huh? That's like a hewed out of a log, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. I never heard a singing like that. Pretty soon. Some thick iron there to divide those glass. That's one of those large original trees outside there on the north side. So this is the wine cellar. Okay, got anything in them? There's names on the bottom of those bottles and printed into the glass.
Mm-hmm. Over here to your left is a fireplace with a dominator, so apparently somebody had to be down here.
Yeah. Shed Romanby's birthplace. Here's that other large original tree on the south side of the house. Looking through these basement windows. Inside that smoke house now. Man, this is a neat smokehouse. Those bars are made of wood. And Leo was up in the rafters to hang things in there. Cook slept in this room then, huh? And treated her good.
Well, that's because her and her husband had special skills.
And you couldn't take them away or you'd starve with it. What was her name?
Edith Hearn Fawcett.
And the whole family lived in here. Very big, is it? Another fig plant on the south side. There's evidently a well. There were those cellar windows that we looked down up in the inside. Looks like we have vegetable gardens down there.
The whole family. What happened then, basically, was World War I. Came through and decimated the Levy family fortune, which I'm sorry, I do not know what it was based on. They came out of World War I, basically very, very poor, and that were ready to bargain with a house. And they had them, maybe I can't find it. He said, cut out the stumps and the undergrowth and the other rubbish, except where they may look well. Cover the whole with grass, interspersed with jessamine and honeysuckle and sweetbriar, and even hardy flowers, which may not require attention. This is a no-maintenance garden for you lazy gardeners. We've limbed up the trees here, we left occasional stumps here and there, and then just the clumps of the natives. We had beautiful, these burned out perennials on the left here. You can see the burned out stalks. Those are Simisifuga, beautiful. One, it was really a wonderful garden, a very great spot. A couple things we didn't do here is he actually asked Lewis and Clark to procure a buck elk to be the monarch of his woods. Of course, we don't know if he ever brought one back or not, but he was very romantic. He wanted this place to have let it be an asylum for hares, squirrels, pheasants, partridges, and every other animal. Procure a buck elk to be, as it were, the monarch of the woods, but keep him shy. A very romantic notion of what was going to happen here. The garden was farmed by the senior slaves, seven senior slaves. They called them the senile corps, actually. Had to work this garden, and they would joke about how when they got to one end, they'd have to start right back at the beginning. It's a bean arbor. Thomas Jefferson had some kind of red bean, which has been growing on that, which he noted in his garden book, has been lost to history. When you lose these seeds, they're completely lost to history. He loved the leech's pea. He ended up with the leech's pea growing more than any other kind of pea. We have no idea what it was. We know that there's a leech's store in Charlottesville. We know there's a knife fight among Thomas Jefferson's descendants in Front Horn.
Feet high.
Oh,
Yeah.
Thomas Jefferson was pretty much of a vegetarian. He used meat as a condiment. And so he liked to experiment with oils. He always had sesames growing here, and also that's why we had the sunflowers. He liked to experiment with sunflower oils. I think I pointed out most of the vegetables. The artichokes behind us. Pansy over there is always kind of a fun one.
Where are they?
Down 200 miles further south, but it's such a warm garden that the figs do very, very well here. Also have gooseberries and raspberries in this garden. And it's such a warm garden, the gooseberries actually don't do very well. They sort of poof out pretty early on. But we try and keep them going for the sake of history. In addition to the Thomas Jefferson Berry Square, you have a U-shaped 8-acre orchard, 300 trees. It's starting way at that end, and I really recommend a walk to the end of this wall. It's a beautiful sight. You can also walk down among here if you want to and hang out with the groundhogs. There's hundreds of groundhogs. So there's a U-shaped 8-acre orchard, and during Thomas Jefferson's day, there were two different types of orchards. There was a north orchard consisting of only apples and peaches, and a south orchard consisting of grafts of more grapes from Champagne, grapes from South Africa every year. Just trying again and failing. What he didn't know about was black rot and phylloxera, these two root diseases that attack the roots. If he had thought to graft onto the native scuppernong or muscadine, he could have gotten a decent burgundy. Although they had grafted it so that it was not even a young hair could get through it. Next to that is the Levy family grave, still owned by the Levy family. And the very last thing to notice is, of course, the only garden structure of all the drawings Thomas Jefferson did, and there were hundreds. This is the only one that got built.
This
guy right here. It was one of his favorite spots. He did not survive even his lifetime here. It blew down in 1820. You can see how it's set in the retaining wall itself, and so it didn't survive a strong storm. So this is the only structure on the property that's a complete recreation. He did five different drawings for a structure in this spot, and they're pretty sure that this is
the lower side of the retaining wall, which kept this side warmer, she said. Down there, it's 30 foot high. Looking at it through the peach orchard, there's some more of the grape vineyard.
Further tells us that Jefferson kept a carpenter's bench and work tools in his greenhouse, that there he would make small repairs to his scientific instruments, and that he was the finest hand, meaning Thomas Jefferson, making small locks, keys, and chains as ever Isaac saw. And who was in a better position to judge than Isaac, who would become eventually head of the blacksmith's shop here. He showed his skill, his industriousness, and trustworthiness to Jefferson early on. And you might say that he is someone who chose under the institution of slavery to max the situation such as it was. Jefferson would take him to Philadelphia, have him trained for 2 years there as a tinsmith. Upon his return, he becomes head of the blacksmith shop and so on. When he leaves this plantation, though, his wife, his two sons, Squire and Joyce, and Mosquito. In that era, they thought a miasma of bad air arising from swamp-like areas was contributing to disease. Jefferson will specifically, when he lays out the University of Virginia, say in his writings that he places it on a high ridge in Charlottesville so that it will be a healthier location. And he will himself retire where the average life expectancy for an adult male could be as little as 8 months after coming over from Africa. So it was really very much a difference of where, you know, of those factors. And
that must have been the mother, because it says her children will rise up and call them blessed.
Yeah. She was a thorny baby. there.